Thanks everyone coming down. Welcome down to Eastern Suburbs School of Music. Karen Downs. Thank our guest, Mr. John Billings. So John, can you tell everyone where you were playing last night?
Last night I was at the Sydney Opera House, and it was a dream come true. And I say that quite seriously. I'm not messing with you. It was something I never thought would happen. And I sat in the restaurant at the Opera House 2.5 years ago with the producer and the drummer having drinks going, and we were looking behind us through the glass going, wow, could you imagine if we ever got to play here? Wouldn't that be amazing? And
last night we did
dreams come true.
We did it.
So how long has the Monkees tour been? John's playing bass, or was playing bass in the Monkees. I saw him in 2016. How all this event came about, I was teaching Ian last Wednesday morning and got a message from John. We've interacted a little bit over the years on Facebook, and said, you've got a music school, you've got music students, is there anything I can do for you? So thank you
for having me tonight. This is a real honor to be able to be here with you guys.
How many shows have been on the tour?
It was seven.
Seven shows.
Three in New Zealand and four here on the continent.
And how did you come to be the bass player in the Monkees?
It's funny you should mention that. It was a bar band of all weird things. As all things are, it's all networking. It's people you know. You play with people that you play with, and you know them, and you trust them. And I was playing in a blues band in a lesbian bar run by twin lesbian sisters that own the club, Rhonda and Jonda. And that is not made up. And I love those women. They're beautiful people. And it was just a wild, drunken, fun gig, blues all the way. And it was this New York guitar player named Wayne Abers. And he just moved to town a few years prior. And I was like, well, what else are you doing? Oh, I play with Mickey Dolenz and I've done some Monkey stuff. I was like, that's hilarious. The Monkees, like, are they still alive? You know, that's what everybody always asks. And one of the gigs, you know, like a few months later, after we'd got to know each other a little bit, he said, we're having some bass player issues. We've got a guitar player playing bass. And would you like to come out for one weekend and just do a Mickey show? And I was like, absolutely, I would love to do that. And literally what I did was I charted the whole show out in my mixture of Nashville number system and actually, you know, writing it note for note, listened to a live DVD that they had that had the old bass player who's passed away, who kind of over the years was playing it the way he wanted to play it. Nothing wrong with that, just that wasn't like the record. And so I learned that to me was the record. And I had a gig at the bar. He and I played the night before until 2 a.m. or something ridiculous. And I just stayed up all night and just read over my charts. And we had a dawn flight going to the other side of the country and just south of, it was in Tacoma, Washington. And I barely slept on the plane. And by the time I got to meet Mickey at soundcheck, I hadn't slept at all since, you know, before that. And I was pretty punchy. And he's like, that's good to meet you. You ready to go do the show? And I go, no, I didn't learn any of it. And he totally believed me. That was it. We played in a Sears, which is a big, big store. And we played in a parking lot. It was a parking lot gig. So I played with Mickey in the parking lot. It went well. I got another gig. Wayne kept calling me. He goes, look, you know, it's yours if you want it. I'm like, yeah, this is wonderful. And everybody in the band is cool. We're all family now. And I think it was 4 years. It might have been 4 years later, or 3 or 4 years later, that the Monkees reconstituted. And this was, because I was just playing for Mickey. And this was with David and Peter and Mickey. And they went out with Davey's band, so we all kind of sat on the sidelines. And when we lost David, when he passed away, they replaced the David band with the Mickey band, and that's how it's been ever since.
Great. Rachel, the bass guitar. Why did you choose the bass guitar?
You know why.
I know
he's
exactly
probably
why.
On this wall somewhere. There he is.
People.
That guy up there, Gene Simmons, ladies and gentlemen. I was a kid. I mean, how cool was Gene Simmons? I was listened to them since I guess I was 12. And I just thought he was just so awesome. So I wanted to be Gene Simmons. And when my father, on my 14th birthday, he gave us, my brother and I, a guitar and a bass. And I got the bass. And my brother Scott got the guitar. And then it was just learning, going out and actually buying a, you know, a Kiss the Kiss notational books and learning the lines out of the book and playing along with the records.
Do you want to do one of those?
Let's do one right now.
Yeah, let's do one right now.
Introduce Shannon, the drummer who I play with in G Force. Great to hear you say that. And Rosie, who I play with in the restaurant at Crown.
Yeah, this is my first. It's not really a solo, but I thought back then when I was a kid, I thought this was a bass.
So this is my first bass solo. And I just learned the song again after, since I'm 52. I learned it when I was 14. He just talked to me at the end of the day.
That'd be $30 too for that lesson.
Right, that's expensive.
All right, we're good. Got a song. I think mine's off. Hang on.
And that was it.
New singer.
And by the way, Gene Simmons is cool, you guys. I see your looks. You don't believe me, but he is. He's a great bass player.
I don't know.
He's got good feel. You can't deny that. Those tunes, I Was Made for Loving You. It should be on your Instagram.
There it goes. Whatever you did. Yeah.
So we've got hands up who's students here at the school, who are bass students. Still one of my students. So you all know what it's like to pick up the instrument for the first time. How long do you feel it took you to get a handle on it?
I still am trying to get a handle on it. I think in life, you know, the further you get into something that you study and you work on, I mean, not to discourage anybody, you feel like you realize how much more there is to know. So I'm still crawling to whatever it is I see in my mind, and the further along I get, I go, oh, I can still do this. But for the most part, to go into clubs or start working with other players, 5 years for me, it was like five before I was in a nightclub playing tunes and learning songs on the radio.
Yep.
I know I went from like really philosophical to really practical in one big motion.
So there you go, it's what I always tell the students, it's just time, give it time, keep working at it.
Yeah.
Keep chipping away.
That's really the key to it all. It never comes quickly. And when it comes quickly, I always find the people that comes quickly, they're the ones who burn out really fast. They don't earn it. Does that sound practical? If you don't earn something, you'd really take it for granted. You're like, I'm good, I don't have to do this anymore. But if you sit there and spend, countless hours, countless every day, and it's you're looking at that KISS picture up there, you're gonna do it. You're gonna keep going and keep going, getting better and better, and you're gonna earn it.
And KISS being the first inspiration, what was the next level? I took giant, crazy steps of
what I liked, like we all did. I went from KISS to, I started playing with this mates in my area when I was probably 15, 16, and they were all listening to a bunch of prog rock. So all of a sudden there's this guy, Chris Squire. And then I played this other band over here that was into Southern rock. So that was, at the time it was Lynyrd Skynyrd and Molly Hatchet. And actually boogie bass lines. Most of the bass lines were kind of like, if I go back now and listen, I go, that's kind of like boogie woogie stuff.
Can you think of an example to kind of stuff?
Give me three steps. Just all boogie woogie kind of stuff.
Well, give me three steps to Mister. Give me three steps for the
door. Give me three. That's Johnny B. Goode slowed down a little bit. And I started hearing more of that stuff. And literally, you get in a band of guys, and they go, "Oh no, we're listening to Rush. So you better go learn." I want you to learn Tom Sawyer and
Free Will.
Yeah, Free Will. Yeah. And you got to start learning all these different styles. And I think when we were younger, we were more open to that. I think later on, we all kind of converge on what we really like. And professionally, we have to still touch all these other areas. But personally, if I go and listen to Larry Graham, oh my God, that's all I want to play. That's all I want to hear. But I'm not playing Larry to make, to make money. I'm playing Monkees, or I'm playing, I used to play for Wynona Judd, and now I'm a country bass player. Now I have to think completely differently. And a little more simply, simply playing and saying more with fewer notes. So really, for now, it's funny, you get to a place where you're starting to do it for a living, and you're concentrating on what's working for that job that you're on, that stage that you're on at that time.
Yeah.
And you mentioned Larry Graham.
Oh my God, Graham's playing the station.
What Larry Graham invented, what was that?
Larry was a slap guy. You've seen guys. He played with his mom in church, and I guess he didn't have a drummer. That's the story he tells. He became the drummer. About the most unthumping bass on the planet Earth. I love this bass, but this is not a thumping bass at all. But that was Larry. Larry was, great singer, amazing bass player, and that was his style of bass playing. He would just, these Minneapolis guys, and they're going in and out. There's this whole style that all grew out of Larry Graham, and I mean, I love his vocals. The guy's awesome, amazing singer. But Larry Graham blew the roof off the place for me.
And that Graham Central Station CD, that's one worth all. Album or digital download, however you get your music
vinyl.
These days, bass players add that one to your
collection. A buddy loaned me his Graham Central Station record, and I never gave it back. I kept it forever. I still have it to this day. It actually is going to hang in my wife's business, one of those like vinyl. Because that's just that to me was a real pivotal thing. But that's a guy, Larry Graham. Then a buddy of mine named Keith Horn, who's another Instagram, Facebook, look up the guy on YouTube, Keith Horn. With an E, crazy good bass player, plays upside down, right-handed bass, but upside down. He just learned how to play like that. So everything he does is backwards. And instead of hitting, he's actually like, he'll used to hit with his fingers. So he thumps differently, and it's ferocious, most ferocious bass player. He said, oh, you gotta check out this guy, Stanley Clark. Stanley Clark back then in the 70s and 80s just ruled the world. And then from there it was, somebody said, you know, there's this guy out there named Jaco Pastorius. You should really take some time and listen to Jaco. And Jaco was in a band called Weather Report that really launched his career. And he was the most amazing melodic harmonic bass player I think you'd ever see out there at that time. And that just set me on this whole path of exploration. You know, somebody opens a door, you step through it, there's another door, and there's two doors now. Which door do you know? And you go down this path of personal enlightenment, and you find so many musicians out there. And you know, you young man, back in our day, you know, there was no internet, so we had to go to the music store, a record store, and get a record. You go to the music store, you'd hang out with guys there, and they'd say, well, there's this guy, you should check this cat out, Geddy Lee. You should go listen to him or something, you know. And it was word of mouth. It was, we'd hand each other cassettes. We gave each other, check this vinyl out, but I want it back, you know. And that's how we learned. And it took time. It took time to just figure out who these people are.
So everyone's astounded at your awesome slap.
Whatever. I don't even get to do that anymore.
Any tips that you'd like to
for slap
pass on? Yeah.
Yes.
I think that's a big
don't
area.
Don't do it for a living. That's my tip. Do it for fun. No, you know what? It's I grew up, I was born in 66. I became musically sentient in, you know, like the late 70s. And you turn on the radio and you'd hear guys play like that. They play like that right here. You know, like
I suppose scat top sound like.
Which is overdubbed. You just hear that sound. Yeah. It became a normal thing for me to hear that on the radio. You wouldn't, like, now you hear that and you're like, holy cow, that guy's slapping on the radio.
It's a real instrument.
Back then, people would do that. And, you know, it's funny, off the top of my head, I can't think of like radio stuff. Well, Duran had slap bass playing in it. You know, these things were on the radio, and it was not uncommon. And you had to, you know, you're in a band, you got to learn how to do that. And so, what I always like to play, and I don't play very well, but I'm gonna play it for you. Yeah. So 777-9311 by this band called The Time, and I think it's Prince. Prince would produce these other bands, but it was really Prince. It was Morris Day and Prince, I believe. And if those guys call me and yell at me, then so be it. But if you ever hear Prince play bass, I'm pretty sure this is Prince on this track. Remember that drum part? Oh my God. It was a drum machine. No, don't play. It was a drum machine. It was a Lindrum. The urban legend is that it was a Lindrum patch that was stock in the machine, and Prince just went, that's cool. And Morris Day wrote this tune called 777-9311 about some fine young lady and her phone number. And this funky groove and this bass playing and things you'd hear on, I'd hear that on the radio and I go, wow, it's just amazing. And that kind of, that style of playing's faded. So if somebody said, how did I learn how to slap? I would go back in time. I would go back, listen to some of these older songs, listen to Prince stuff. Prince didn't have a lot of it on his hits, but he had it sometimes on the records. That band, The Time, has some great bass playing. I'm pretty sure it's Prince. I don't think it's Terry Lewis. Who else am I trying to think of? It was a pop band that had that. Kaja Goo Goo, Too Shy to Shy. You know, these were songs that were on the radio. It was normal to slap. Everybody slapped. And then just over a period of time, it became kind of, you know, synth bass came in that became passe. But it's still fun to do. And then, you know, every now and then you get, somebody goes, you know, we're going to, you know, the Wooten Brothers, we'd always do Sly and the Family Stone. And we'd bust into that for 20 minutes, you know. So that that's fun stuff to play in clubs where you've got a listening audience and they want to get funky and have fun. That's the kind of music that's a lot of fun to play. And I finally get to do that. But usually, normally, my everyday Monkey World or whatever the other gigs I'm doing, even when I was with Donna Summer, there wasn't all a slap bass playing. I played with Donna for a while. There was no slap bass playing. It was all, you know, all finger stuff. Really, I don't get to do that in my professional world.
Yeah.
And every
the
now and then.
Disco Queen that didn't have
They didn't have slap bass. It was just mostly like, you know, everybody familiar with Chic? Good times. That's Bernard Edwards. It was mostly finger style and some pick stuff too. Wasn't a lot of slap bass playing, you know, on those tracks. Nothing wrong. I mean, they were still funky. Don't get me wrong. And Donna's bass lines are great.
You mentioned Donna Summer. Which was your first sort of big professional artist that you'd worked with?
That was Donna. I had worked with a bunch of people. I was in Los Angeles for 8 years, and I did one-offs with a lot of my heroes and people that I really admired, but then there'd be nothing else. You'd never play with them again, or you'd never do another gig with them. It was an event or a concert, and you do that hit and move on. And that plagued me for 8 years. I just couldn't get a foothold. And all my Virginia people, where I'm from, gravitated to Nashville, Tennessee, and they were coming to LA and doing gigs in LA, and I couldn't get a gig in LA. So something's wrong with this picture. So Reggie Wooten, the Wooten brothers, Victor Wooten's family, kind of encouraged me to come out. Some of my friends, one of my buddies from LA was out there. He's like, you got to get to Nashville. It's really happening. We're all working. We've all got gigs. I came to visit a couple times, and I would play with the Wooten brothers, and we would do our usual, you know, so good, so good. I got you, you know, and play those James Brown tunes, and people were listening and paying attention. And it's something I hadn't experienced in LA. I go to Los Angeles and I play gigs to a smattering, a half the size of this room, and there's no money. And now I'm in Nashville and everybody's paying attention. And these guys are killing it, you know, and Victor's on the road, he wouldn't play with his family. They would always get a different bass player. So I'm kind of building up to, I came to Nashville and my whole life opened up. I got here on a Friday night, and by Sunday, I had auditioned for and got a country gig, a road gig. And I was like, I've been in LA for 8 years and I haven't left town yet. And here it is, I got a gig 2 days later. And then 2 months later, I got a call to come to help somebody at rehearsal. And he didn't tell me who it was for. He just said, I've got a rehearsal and it's a birthday thing. It's my birthday, I'm going out to the birthday dinner for my wife, and I need you to cover the rehearsal for me. Sure, and I showed up. It was a Donna Summer audition. It was a ruse. He just didn't want the word to get out. And that was in early April, beginning of May, I was in Brazil. And that started like a 16-year run with her. It was amazing. She was an amazing woman. It was amazing music. Stepping out on stage in front of people who like worshiped her. They really did. It was incredible. You know, and you'd start to take it for granted. You just naturally take things you do every day for granted. And every now and then I'd step on that stage and there's people just looking at them, you know, tears coming down. It was an amazing gig. And I stayed with her until she passed away.
How familiar with her music were you before you got the gig?
You know, it's like the Monkees. I knew it was on the radio. I didn't know the deep cuts. And I had a lot of homework to do. And all of that was charted. Everything had been meticulously charted out by the musical director at the time. So I had, at least I had a starting point, and I could go do that work, listen to the cassette they gave me, and then you're out playing it. Then it's on, and then by that time you're acclimated, you're playing it, you own it.
Any favorite parts out of songs?
Man,
you remember?
We should have worked some of that up today.
Yeah.
I like
this
Bad
really.
Girls.
Sorry, this really came together quick. It was like Friday. Let's go ahead and do it. So.
I like Bad Girls. I still love to play Bad Girls. Do you know that one? By chance? Oh my God.
Can we do Bad Girls?
Sure.
I haven't sang it before.
I haven't sang it.
I know the song.
Oh, okay.
You're a
crack. No.
All right. We're not going to put Rosie on the spot. That's all right.
I'll have.
I love playing Bad Girls. That was always fun. And this is not the bass line. This is the bass line I play. And that was, you know, Bad Girl. You know, it's funny when you play bass for somebody, nobody ever knows the tune. You can play the bass line, they're like, well, I've never heard of that. That's Donna Summer.
There's a room full of bass players, I think, everyone.
They're all going, I don't know. That sounds like
they know that.
I love that. I love Heaven Knows. I don't know if you guys remember Heaven Knows. That was a big hit for her. And now I get to play that every now and then. I'm in a band. We all do side gigs. I'm in a wedding band. They don't even know. I don't think half of them know I used to work for Donna. And we'll do Heaven Knows and do Last Dance. And you're like, Last Dance, that's amazing. You know, like, I worked on it. Did my homework.
Cool. But I love all those songs. And
those are tricky just to play on bass. They don't make any sense, you know, but you put the unit, the combo together.
So how do you go about learning the set list, learning the repertoire, aside from obviously getting the tracks, getting some charts, what works best for you to remember parts?
My thing is I have to listen to it in the car. I have to, which is not always efficient. I sit and listen to it. I make a CD and put it in my CD player in my car and listen to it when I drive. And when I can tune my brain out and I'm hearing what's going on, because otherwise we're on our phone and excuse me, I'll be right back, and I get diverted so easily. So I like to go when I go running, I listen to it. Biking, I listen to the music. When I drive, I like to listen to it, and I listen to it till I can start to sing the choruses. That's how I learn it, and then I go back. Now I'm going to go sit down with the bass. And I'm going to work on the bass line because now I know the form. And so to me, the getting the form of the song is what I have to do, the first thing.
And do you see, are you a purist? Do you want to learn the notes that are on the recordings, or are you happy to take some liberties?
Maybe we should poll the room before I answer that question. For you purists out there, not always. Now, it depends on the gig. Donna did not demand that I learn note for note the song. She just wanted it to feel good. She wanted me to be expressive when I played, not just to stand there. She wanted me to be moving, and you're working for the artist, you're working for the boss, so you do what they say. And with the Monkees, they want more precision. The producer of the show has specifically said, I want you to go to the records and listen to the original parts. So that was the direction given to all of us. Rick Springfield, no, I just get out there and rock, you know. And that's great. And you can put a little bit of your flourish on there. Not a lot. You want to play their songs. But I don't get asked to play the exact line. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know, it's like you go and you play in a club band. They want you to know the song, but not everybody wants you to meticulously play the exact line all the time. That's not a requirement. But when it is, you better nail it, you better know it. And sometimes you have to get a sense of the person you're working for. They don't always tell you. You have to kind of, you get to playing with them and working with them, and you get a sense really quick if they want you to play the exact line. I worked with a country artist that if I deviated an eighth note, she would turn around, I shouldn't say she, that person would turn around and look at me. and they knew their own lines. That's, and I was amazed. I was like, how in the world does a singer know all the bass lines like perfectly? They know, she knew all the drum fills, she knew the guitar parts, and if they were missing, it threw her off her game and sent her down this course of, she's not gonna be happy with her performance. I get why she wanted it that way, because that's how she learned her own material that way. She's heard the record 1,000 times.
That's it, exact. Yeah. Just before we move forward, any questions from the floor from what we've covered so far?
Anybody got tweeting while we're doing this? Am I getting favorable remarks? I wanted to say too that all these gigs and all this path that I've been on is, I was talking with Caleb about this the other night. It's one thing runs into the next, it's run into the next. I've met these five people, and from that spawned another five people, and from that spawned another five people. And you soon have a network of musicians, professionals that will call you because they know that you'll learn your parts, you'll learn the show, you won't embarrass the boss, you don't have BO on the bus, or stinky feet, which is just as important as learning your parts, because no one wants to be on the bus with somebody that smells bad. And it really is a game of people who know each other. And I know that sounds unfair, because we all feel like we should be able to audition and show what we do. But you spend an hour in a 24-hour day, I spend an hour and a half of that day playing music, playing my job. The other, doing math again, 22.5 hours of the day are spent living with everybody, eating with you. We went to the bathroom at the gas station together, and we got drunk. That's the whole day, really. And even the artist expects you to be able to be somebody they can be around, not annoying. That doesn't mean kiss their butt. That just means be nice, be pleasant. Don't have a rain cloud over your head everywhere you go. And oh, life sucks. Don't be that person. Don't be fake either. But just be yourself. Be realize the blessing that you're there, and you have a gainful employment, and that this person wants you in their presence. And I think if you see that as a blessing, it's easy to be in a good mood. It's easy to feel good about what you're doing. And not be, crabby. Crabby people get fired.
Made it last, that's for sure. Yeah. So, Donna Summer gig, you've got a resume, though. Any muso would be pretty envious of. You've worked with a disco queen. You've worked with one of the big Aussie rock stars that's coming over here, Rick Springfield. You've worked with jazz singers.
Yeah.
Before, tell them a little bit about
it. I did a one-off with, I wish it wasn't a one-off, but it was actually in a classroom like this with Nancy Wilson, not the heart Nancy Wilson, but the jazz singer Nancy Wilson. She was amazing. She was incredible. And that was when I worked with a jazz pianist in Los Angeles named Johnny Hammond Smith. There's two. One's that guy. But this guy was an older jazz artist. And I think when I was playing with him, I think he was in his 70s. I never knew how old he was. I knew he'd been around because he told me he played with Coltrane. So he's been around. And he goes, I remember hiring George Benson on guitar. So this guy had been there and done it. And I was doing Saturday morning jams with him. He would pay the band to just come out and play his charts. He'd write these charts out, and we would come in Saturday morning, 10 a.m., and we'd play for a couple hours. And then from that, he would get little gigs, and we'd go and play. So Nancy Wilson was one.
And previous, how much jazz bass playing experience had you had?
When I was in Virginia, I went to, I'm the college dropout. I'm embarrassed to tell everybody. So I squoze through 1 year of music school, and I just realized that wasn't where I needed to be. I didn't need to be in bass education or the music education, which is why you go to music school. It's for education, is to teach. And I was like, I came here to learn how to play. So I got from that experience, I worked with a bass master, a guy named Clarence. Good forgetting names. My age is showing. Clarence C, S-E-A-Y. And Clarence was an old school you know, upright guy, that action was this high off the neck, and he would just kill it. And he and I didn't have an acoustic bass. I went to college with my electric, and they're, you know, you go to college with your electric bass, they used to frown on you. They go, don't come to class with that thing. And so he loaned me his spare upright that had action even higher on it. You couldn't even hit the F on the E string. Like, I would just kind of ghost it. But I got a great jazz education from those guys, being in those combos in school, studying Jaco, studying Stanley Clark, studying, listening through osmosis, listening to Stanley play with Chick Corea, and you're hearing Chick and his chords and his changes. I got to play with some amazing guys. I was in school with James Genus. He was my pal at school, and he's like the jazz bass player. He was here a week ago. He was in Melbourne with Herbie Hancock. Anybody heard of Herbie Hancock? James is the man. So I was surrounded by these amazing players, and I'd get to go hear him play in combos. James ended up going out with the Marcellus family. He was playing with Ellis, the father, and went to New York and ended up playing with, I think it was Branford, and that kind of got his start. Steve Wilson was a saxophone player from Richmond who, again, played with Chick Corea and has his own career. These people were just all around, you know. You go to a club and Steve's playing sax, and Carter Beauford from Dave Matthews was in a band that I used to go listen to in Richmond, and, you know, he was just the funky pocket guy. You know, it wasn't a lot of fancy stuff. He had a backbeat you would not believe. The guy's got feel for days. But you could just go to a club and hear him play. And Victor was just a guy who lived in Virginia, and we all loved his bass playing, but he was just one of our pals. And we were watching, before we came over here, he had Dead & Company on. And the bass player's O'Teal Burbridge. And O'Teal and I were in, you know, top 40 bands at the same time in Virginia Beach, and he was just O'Teal, you know? Now he's O'Teal. With war paint on, apparently, when he's playing.
Yeah, he's still that.
So there was, I was really fortunate that there was this cadre of amazing musicians, and a lot of the jazz I got was osmosis, just from being around it, immersed in it.
Any little tweak you remember for your walking bass lines that you like?
You know, it's funny, my first walking bass line I learned was, I was 16 years old, it was taught to me by a drummer. He was in music school, and he goes, man, you can't play no bass. And he wrote down, he goes, play this, because you know I could read. So it was, like, he wrote that down. He goes, I just play that over, except for the tag at the end, play that over and over again, and there's F blues. And it's funny, that thing is like imprinted on my brain. But so I hate to admit it, I still gravitate to that, his direction that he goes in, and how he's coming out of it, and his passing tones. I'm like, damn, that drummer, that dude totally like burned that into my brain. But it was, you know what, it was great. And I think just listening to more and more bass players doing that stuff, it started sinking in. My college guy, Clarence C, was a master of walking bass. And he would be walking on a song, and you're like, is that F blues? I can't even tell if that's F blues or not. But he could play so out and bring it all back in, which just means he's playing changes that are in the harmonic structure, but they're not rooted. They're chasing some of the other notes in the scale, and he sounds like he's playing another song, and then all of a sudden it glues back into where it's supposed to be, and it seems like magic the first time you hear it. And I, surrounded by it, I just heard it all the time.
And that's it, essentially, how you got to do it, is immerse yourself.
Oh yeah. I had come home from school, and I would, I mean, there's no school-age kids in here, but I would come home from school, and that's the first thing it is. I started listening to records, and I did that until my mom said, you're done. It's time for bed, and I'd get a bite to eat.
That sounds familiar, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. And that level of immersion, when you're young, you can do that. You know, when you're young, you have that time to do it. And if you love it, you don't even think about it. I mean, it seemed like it was a time machine. I put on a record and play to it, and then it was dark outside. It's time to go to bed. But that doing that every day, 7 days a week, years on end, and then going into a playing situation of real school players. That was the other thing. I was always the young guy. when I was 16, I was playing with college kids, and they clicked something in me. They took me from here to here, and that was the first big leap that I took. They just, you know, those guys were all the piano player. That's what it was, Lucy Lawrence. She's a piano player in Richmond, Virginia. They don't hire bass players because of her, because she plays bass with her left hand so good that a lot of the best harmonic ideas I got are from her playing bass with her left hand. She's amazing. And you just immersed with all these amazing players around you. And I think that was the thing that pushed me at a faster clip than some of the other cats that I knew, you know, back at home. Because I was hanging out with these brilliant musicians. You know, they always say don't be the smartest guy in the room. It's so true. You're not learning if you're the smartest guy in the room. You're not learning, you're not progressing. And I was definitely the runt of the litter. I was around some amazing players, and that just kind of pushed me along into that world a little faster.
So you've been a rock player, you've been a disco funk type player.
Oh yeah.
Done a little bit of jazz. Living in Nashville though, you finally get a country gig with Wynona Judd.
Well, when you're in Nashville, everybody goes through the you go through the same gigs. So we all play for Tanya Tucker. Everybody plays for Tanya Tucker. Might be one weekend, it might be a couple years, but you're gonna play with Tanya Tucker, and that's a really good that's a really good. I shouldn't be laughing. It's a lot of inside stuff going on. But Tanya, if you look up Tanya Tucker Wikipedia, you'll be like, oh man, she's just a wild child. But she's a brilliant singer. She's a brilliant performer. And from there, you start bouncing around. Everybody trades gigs. And one weekend, I was out with Ty Herndon, and then I'd be out with Shelley Wright. And I can't even think of all the ones. Sometimes you do these one-offs of artists. You'll have a buddy who'll call you and go, my kid's sick, I can't go out on the road with, you know, with artist X. I've got a book, I made a book. And which is basically the Nashville number system. And you listen to everything, you read the charts, you're like, I can do that.
So anyway, you could quickly describe what that Nashville number system means, because we might have heard of it before, but it might not make sense to...
It's a really interesting way that Nashville musicians write music for each other. And it's not the misconception is that they can't read music. It's not that, it's a fast shorthand for chords. It's a diatonic. The word is diatonic, which means it's in the scale. It's a diatonic, we're in the key of G. That's our one chord. A is 2, 3B, 4, C, D, all the way up to G again. That is it. You know, a flat 3, they'll write 3 flat, which would be B flat. They've got some hieroglyphics that they'll do for what they call split bars. There's a whole different nomenclature in Nashville, split bar. So if you've got two chords in a bar, G to C, that was a split bar. It splits between G and C, and they'll underline those two chords, and that means, and sometimes they'll put beat markers beneath them, but it's a really fast, very efficient shorthand for music. You could do it on the fly. I'm not that good at it. It takes me a few tries to get it. But I watch guys literally listen to a song and they write the entire song out as it's playing, and they don't need to go back and do it. Again, they don't need to review anything. It's really crazy to see. They've just been doing it their whole lives. And that's called the Nashville Number System.
And that's kind of, I know I'm touching on that with some of my...
It's very handy.
...students at the moment, just in terms of looking at
scale. You know what? And you could change the key.
Yeah.
You can go, instead of G, now I want to play in the key of F. Well, if we had notated that out in manuscript paper and with treble clef and bass clef, now we got to rewrite the entire thing. But in the number system, it stays the same. Now it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's, or 1. It can be in any key. So when you have a singer who doesn't feel comfortable with that key, you can drop it, you can raise it, you just read the numbers.
And for guitar players, a little bit like when we move the capo
to those different spots. That's exactly right.
It's like, well, we get to do. Country bass playing, I think just root fives.
Yep, root fives. On the older stuff, there was a period of time there when I was working with this woman named Wynona Judd, and Wynona of the Judds. And Y loves soul, she likes R&B, and she loves Led Zeppelin. So holy cow, I mean, it's John Paul Jones, it's like, you know, the bass player from Chaka Khan, you could do, that's what she loves. So I got to actually be a little more expressive on a low end. And I just a thump solo in country music. I'd go out there with her and we'd dance and I'd thump around a little bit.
In parts that you remember from playing with her that were your favorites? Or?
We played Rock and Roll by Led Zeppelin. And she'd be out there in that big red hair, you know, screaming her guts out on that song. It was amazing. But I'm trying to think of like something that we would, I can't remember what I soloed on with her. I would go out with her and everybody would drop off and I would thump on A minor for about a minute and she'd dance around and laugh. But I love playing, actually what I love playing with her were the old Judd songs, which were just, you know, all whole notes. Tell me about the good old days. And I love those songs. They're really simple, beautiful songs, beautifully sung by, she's an amazing vocalist, incredible, one of the best vocalists we have on the planet. Nobody's really aware of it like they should be. And hearing her do those songs, I mean, sometimes at night, you know, we'd be playing it, you know, I get a little, you know, I got some in my eye. And that was sincere, I really felt that way. And half of those songs were just, kick drum patterns all night long, and I would, that's my entertainment when it was really simple stuff, is I would just vary my walk downs and walk ups, and I'd do a little something that's not going to get me in trouble at the same time, it's not, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah, we did a lot of interesting stuff with Y, and her husband was a drummer, and he was a funky drummer, so everything had a little grease on it. You know, it allowed us to have a lot of fun with all some of her old songs.
And does that then lead from Wynona Judd, the next major gigs, the Mickey Dolenz?
I guess it was. I was doing. What was really crazy at that time? I was playing with Donna, Wynona, and Mickey, all simultaneously. Because nobody, I don't know anybody, stays on the road. Most people go out for a period of time, come home because they have families, and it's not practical to stay out on the road. So they'll go, I'm going to take 6 months off to find myself. And you're like, oh, that's great. I'm broke. I don't get paid for 6 months. What else can I do? And I call my little network of buddies and I just kind of go, yeah, well, we took 6 months off. Yeah, so if you got anything, and you know, you would get called to do another gig. So Donna Summer would take huge swaths of time off, months at a time. And well, Wynona had dates, and I would go out and play with Wynona. And then I'd go out and do Rick weekends. Rick would just go out on the weekends, all fly dates. He flies everywhere. And I was able, believe it or not, the calendar worked out for a while there where I was doing all three gigs at the same time and not overlapping. And finally, it wasn't Rick Spring. That was Mickey Dolenz. It was Mickey, Donna, and Wynona. And finally, Wynona and the Monkees' first incursion into the world of me at the bass, the dates bumped into each other, and I had to make a decision. And, you know, the Monkees were working their lot, and that was the easy decision to make. I love Wynona, and you know, she's awesome. And I had a blast doing that gig. It's just one of those things, you know, talk to your spouse, you talk to your friends, and you know, just goes where it takes you.
You gotta pay the bills, don't you?
The bills don't pay themselves. That's the rule number one. We all know that.
So, as I said earlier, lucky enough to see the band on Saturday night. It was down here. And what blew me away, I love the whole show. But you closed with I'm a Believer, and it was great to hear the actual bass line from it.
My interpretation of
it. Yeah, well, that's it, yeah. But just the bass, like, a song where I'm a fairly big Monkees fan, so I'm a Believer wasn't the tune I was really looking forward to listen to. I loved all the deeper cuts we could hear, but what really blew me away was, yeah, the bass part. So do you want to get Shannon back up? Do you want to do some backing vocals? Feel free to chip in with some backing vocals too, Robbie, if you want.
We need to be doing Purple Sky.
So yeah, let's have a listen to what John gets to do. I think all of us almost in this room who've picked up an instrument. I think we've all played I'm a Believer at some stage, haven't we? In every cover gig, wedding band, you name it.
Man, this bass does not like to get slapped on a holy cow. I'm all out of tune.
So here's what it gets to do. Me, Mickey Dolan slash Monkees. Ah. Pleasure to hear on Saturday.
I might have ripped off the keyboard solo. Sorry about that.
But I loved it. Yeah, the unison part.
I love that song, and I always played it. I always played it wrong. I always played it, you know, every chorus. And we had talked about that earlier.
It's, yeah, which you guys would be interested in hearing about how you went about
the producer
learning
the show.
It.
Well, I heard it in Starbucks. I realized I'd been playing it wrong. I was like, oh man, flat white, large. The first two choruses, I'm really, this is bass geekdom. My apologies.
Which you got a whole heap of bass players here, so then.
First chorus. That's all it. And even Peter Tork, speaking very reverently, Peter, but he gave me grief. He's like, that's not the right time. And I go, well, actually, the first two choruses are different from the whole rest of the song. I mean, back in the day, they would just, the bass player in the middle of the tune would just change what he's doing. And so after the keyboard solo is the key. The chorus after that goes to the line that everybody knows.
And it goes the second time, so that's the third chorus goes through. Session that day, and a lot of this stuff I got to really find out because the producer of the show has the masters and literally just plays me the track, and he'll give me a mix of drums, keys, or mostly just drums, vocals, and like the lead vocal on the left and bass on the right, and I'm like, holy cow, this is amazing. I get to hear the track and it's nuts. That's when I realized they're playing for pick. I never hear the pick in the mix ever. And when you listen to all the solo tracks, it's all pick. The only time it's not a pick is sometimes Peter would play, every now and then they let him play bass. And usually he would play with his fingers, or later he's playing these picks, these finger picks, like a dobro guy would use, which is interesting sonically. But yeah, it was all with the pick. And you just, I guess by the process of them, you know, blending. Back then they only had 4 tracks or 8 tracks or maybe 2 8-track machines slaved, possibly. So they'd have to do mix downs. And somewhere along the line, I feel like that pick just went away. And it just turned into, which I still play like that. I left hand mute everything. But really, it's all pick, and just, I guess, the process of making the song and the mix, we kind of lose that attack. So I put the attack back in.
The fidelity of the day, as we were talking about earlier, the bounce downs. And
it's interesting to go back and listen to these ISO tracks, and like you hear Marvin Gaye. And to me, it sounds as good quality-wise as anything that would sound today. But in the course of making the mix, the master, cutting the lathe, making the copies on vinyl, it's like the sound kind of changes. But really, if you listen back to some of these old bass parts, it sounds like a guy went in and plugged into a DI and played his part. It sounds just like he did it last week. It's just in the process of the mix, it goes through whatever it's going to go through.
And gear for the tour.
Oh,
let's get into the gear and what these level. I think everyone in the room is going to go out and buy one of these basses.
Tuner and bass. That's awesome. It. Next question. No, it's, well, for the Aussie trip, I had to carry with me what I had, so I wasn't going to take very much. So usually what I'll do is for the monkey stuff, some of the stuff that, like again, Peter would play on was distorted. Was just like, Circle Sky is this really cool Michael Nesmith written song the Monkees did, and Peter Tork's playing bass, and it's like, so I have a little fuzz box. It's called it's a way huge pedal called a pork loin, and it's the reason I love that pedal. It was one of the first techs that worked with this with the Monkees. The first year I went out, I was complaining that, man, I need to get a little dirt on my signal. But not, you know, you put a distortion pedal on bass, most of the time all the low end is gone, and it's just this annoying mid-range that's got no definition on low end. And he suggested this pedal, and the way huge guy literally was down the hall at SIR in Los Angeles, and he came back with this big purple pedal, and he plugged it in. I was like, oh, now I've got bass and I have some dirt on it. So normally I'll carry a tiny little TC Electronics tuner, like the little baby guy, the poly.
Tiny guy.
He can't even put a battery in it, but you can put it on a little pedal board. And I'll have my pork loin on there, and I have the tone knob dimed. And essentially, that's just a gain in and a volume control out, so you can drive gain and bring down the output so that they're matched with your clean sound.
And dimed, is that on 10?
Dimed on 10, baby.
Yep.
You dime it, man, all the way. But I just put a little dirt on there because I made the mistake of listening to some show multi-tracks that I had played on, and holy cow, I had really overdid it with the distortion. And once it's on there, man, it don't come off. So I try to just get a light grunge so that when I do stuff like Circle Sky, there's a little bit of that dirt on there, like Peter did. Peter had a sun cabinet or something from the 70s, and he had it dimed, I'm sure, because they didn't have PAs. They were playing with their amps on stage. And the recording of that, to me, is so cool. So I try to capture some of that. So I have that pedal, and on that gig, that's all I use. I don't have any other. I have a radial switcher, because what I'll do is I'll play different basses. I'll have this bass, and then I've been playing a Epiphone Thunderbird Vintage Pro, which, man, the low end on that is monstrous. It's beautiful. But if I just had a regular switcher, there'd be a distinctive, you know, level change. So I have a radial bass tone. I think it's called bass tone. And it's just a two-channel switcher. It has, and one of the channels has EQ. You can actually affect one of the channels. And I just set the loudest bass on that channel and bring the level down a little bit, so that I switch basses. I hit that button, and the sound man's not hearing, you know, oh my God, we're so much louder now, or the low end is overpowering. it gives him a steady vibe, and that's it. That's all I care for that gig.
And is that the Porcline pedal, is that on most of the time, or just
certain songs?
And you could hear it out front nicely too.
Well, this, unfortunately for this tour, that's it. I didn't even bring cables. Reese had to loan me cables. It's so pathetic, right? But I just wanted to go as light as possible. But normally the Porcline's on. I can't remember the other song I have it on. I usually kick it in on first, definitely for Circle Sky. And the new one, Birth of an Accidental Hipster.
Yeah.
Birth of an Accidental Hipster, the track is pretty, the bass is pretty grungy. So I'll use it on that. And I'm missing another one. Oh, Porpoise Song. Are you guys Monkee fans at all? Like deep cut Monkee fans? Yeah. There's a song called The Porpoise Song, and it was written by Carol King, sorry, yes. He wins. Carol King. And it's a strange song, but it's really beautiful. And there's a whole outro that it's real orchestral with, like, you know, the bell.
Big psychedelic.
Yeah. I can't play the whole song.
And that's all I do. I just do an ostinato bass part, which is the same thing over and over again. But I kick that pork loin in. Holy cow. Chris Squire. It just sounds so good, you know, through the rig, and it sounds great in the house. But I kicked that in just at the end of the song when the big orchestral, you know, vibe hits.
And Epiphone, why'd you choose?
I love Epiphone.
Yeah.
And I met a developer over there named Richard
Akers. He was my daughter's soccer football coach.
And we were at the end of the season pizza party that you have. And I didn't even know what Coach Richard did. And I heard him tell somebody that he worked over at Epiphone. And you know, of course, Epiphone, hey, I love those Jack Cassidy basses. How do I get one, you know? And that started off our relationship. And I would go pay them a visit. Their shop is 3 miles from my home in Nashville. So my wife and I will actually just go in and just say hi sometimes. And they're great. They've been wonderful to us. My wife and I have a video production company, and we've done some video work for those guys. So we'll go over there and shoot something for them, and switch, you know, trade out a bass or trade out, like, my wife's starting a wine bar, and it's lined with Epiphone guitars. We have 9 Epiphone guitars up on the wall. It's rock and
roll. Sounds like someone's house, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly. So I just wanted a Cassidy bass. I always loved them. I thought they were cool. I had played one in a music store. I thought it was amazing. And I was like, man, one day I'm gonna get a Cassidy bass.
And we were starting a Monkees tour. And I don't even think I told Richard when I met him what anything I did. I just said, I'm a bass player going on tour. I'd love to have one of these to take on tour with me. And he goes, yeah, send me your resume. And I mean, I hit send on the computer, and like 5 minutes later, it was like, come by, pick it up right now. And that's the gold Epiphone that I have. And I played that religiously for a few years with those guys. And then just recently, and then I picked this up for a tour. We had a real special tour. And I said, I want to keep playing Cassidy's, the Monkees stuff, because it's just the appropriate bass. It sounds like an old bass. It looks like one. It's easy to play for me. And it sounds, for a passive bass, it's got a lot of body to it, body to the tone. So we had a special tour. They gave me this to take out. I love it. And for this last round in June, I started taking out their Vintage Pro Thunderbird basses, which is just, you know, I can't even reach the end of the headstock. I'm not kidding you. When I go to tune the thing, I lean in to tune the bass. It's enormous, but it's so cool. It's so cool to play. It looks cool. And there's a low end that is undeniable. That sounds so good. And it's, I hate to say that it's more appropriate for the monkey stuff than this bass, because they're just different. Bass instruments are different. But when I started playing the Thunderbird with them, the low end came to life. Mm. You know, the front of house guys noticed it. I noticed it. You could just feel it.
It's a big
it's a big bass sound. And then, you know, then you go back and you think about how often that bass was used in rock and roll, and you're like, well, now I get it. I totally get it. I mean, even Nikki Six is still playing Thunderbirds, for crying out loud. There's a reason that bass sounds great for rock.
And your favorite bass of all time that you've played?
Well, I don't want to, like,
favorite instrument that you've had.
I need to put this down and have this discussion. No, I think I have two basses that are in my world that are like my kids. And as when I was 17, I bought a Music Man Stingray. This was 1983. I bought that. I was just a kid. I saved up $500 and drove. My parents let me drive to Maryland, which was about a three-hour trip. That was a big deal for them. And I saw some young kids playing Louis Johnson licks on his bass. And Louis is another famous slapper. You know, Lewis is always all thumb, overhand thumb. He would come from up here. I can't do it. He would swing from this far away. I was surprised the bass didn't break into little pieces. And they were playing all these cool Lewis Johnson licks on that bass. And they weren't going to buy anything. It was like a Guitar Center Sunday morning. You know, everybody just shows up and plays stuff. And I sat over and watched this amazing display. And the kids put the bass down and got it and walked off, and I ran over and grabbed it and took it to the desk and said, I want this one. And so I've had that since that was my first pro bass. And just recently my wife, I put a Kaler bridge on it. I ruined that bass. I took all the tone out of it. I was 17. I mean, come on, what do we do when we're 17? I mean, like, I jumped stuff with my bike and, you know, hurt myself, and, you know, you went out with the wrong woman, you know, everything. So, of course, I ruined my bass. And then just years of playing it, it just needed to be set up. I broke off two separate screws in the horn for the strap that were just lodged in the bass for all time, never to be taken out. I just put it in the closet and never looked at it again. My wife pulled it out on my birthday, before my birthday, and had a luthier go through the whole thing, replace the bridge, do all this. She tricked me into telling her what was wrong with the bass. She goes, why don't you play that bass? And then she ran her phone like she was videoing me. She goes, I'm just doing this for the kids. And it needs to be bridge and the horns. I'm missing screws in the horn. And she got the whole thing tweaked out. And then said, why don't you go look at your bass? And of course, went to go check it out. And it was like I had tears. I mean, it was like having an old friend back. And just picking it up and hearing all those Louis Johnson licks that were still in my head, and all that tone. And I don't know if you're ever familiar with, like, a Music Man, and nothing sounds like a Music Man bass. And this model was before the company went over to Ernie Ball. So it's, the electronics are different. It's got this thing. When I thump on it, it sounds like a Simmons kick drum. Like it takes you, it hits you in the chest. And I have a Federa. I bought a, which is like buying a Ferrari in the bass world. I bought a Federa probably in the late 90s, and that bass, there's something spiritual about that bass. I feel like when I put that in my hands, like, a whole another world opens up.
And amp-wise?
Amp-wise, so. I use Trickfish amps. I have a relationship with their president who passed away January, a year ago. I still love those guys. They make these Class D amps, tiny cabinets, light heads. It's like the Mark bass. The heads don't weigh anything. I could pick my head up and hold it out like that. It's like under 5 pounds. Really powerful. I have a 1,000-watt head that I'll play with the Monkees. A 4 12 cabinet. I think they had 12s. I'm stupid that I don't know that. You know, you get your gear, you just bring it to the gig, you know? You stop looking at it after a while. I'm like, oh yeah, they're 12s, they're not 10s. But the most of the time in around Nashville, I play a single, oh, you know what, this 410 cabinet and it's a single 12 cabinet that I carry. I'll take that to like 90% of my gigs. It's a single 12 and a head. And I walk, I have my mono bag on with whatever bass I'm gonna play, and I have a gym bag for my head, and I'm carrying the speaker. So I have done what no bass player has ever done before, to walk from my car to the gig and not have to go back. I mean, we all are doing that now, but you know, I remember, you know, you drag the PV cabinet out of the car and it tears the carpet up on the way out, and you know, get that disc damage and the SVT head that's 90 pounds. That's what I remember. So for me to be able to just walk into a club with this little tiny rig, I love Trick Fish. It's wonderful. Mike Pope is doing electronics. He's doing the EQ and that. And it can get dirty if you want it to. You can drive it. For the most part, I play it pretty clean. I keep the EQ pretty flat. If I have the little 12 on, I'll pump a little bottom in into that 12. But I keep the thing flat. I love it. The bass sounds like what it's supposed to sound like. I don't have to turn a bunch of knobs and try to milk it to get that sound.
Is that a brand bass players here have heard of as well? Trick Fish?
I tried very hard to bring them here.
Yeah.
And they tried too. They called all the local guys in Melbourne. They called Backline guys. They called some stores, and they said, we'll send it at cost. We'll do, you know, we want to make this happen, get these things down there. And our buddy John wants to play them at the show. And just nobody, it's just such an expense, shipping and everything else. So we tried to make it happen.
Look amazing. I like the on each EQ you've got a selectable.
Yeah, you got a selectable.
Like for what
you've got every band. It's got two choices: a band that it will boost or cut, and the 1,000-watt head. They're all LEDs that you can see from like about a mile away.
Yeah, it looked really cool on stage. You could see it.
I'm sure the light guy loves that.
Yeah, Greg. Any gear questions? Anyone might have at this stage? Just about hitting the Q&A.
Anybody want to know about how the tone is of this tuner? Trick question, there is no tone.
True bypass or buffet or...
True bypass.
Yeah. Any key questions? Any general questions as we start to sort of wind it? Yeah.
Yeah, John, you've obviously achieved a lot and worked with a lot of fantastic musicians. Have you ever gotten to a stage in your career where you've kind of gotten stale?
I mean, we're all human. Sometimes I feel doing the opposite thing is the right thing to do. Sometimes I don't touch this. I've not touched it for a month at a time. And because I feel like I have gotten stale. I'm playing the same stuff all the time, or I'm not playing what makes me happy. I'm just playing what's paying the bills. And I don't know if you want to call it like the bad times or perfect timing, but I'll have like a period where I'm not on the road. I don't have a wedding gig. I don't have a studio session. I do, I'm also a photographer and a videographer and an engineer, and I'll get a bunch of those gigs. I don't even tell them, they don't even know I'm a bass player. Most of them don't know anything about me. I'm the guy that's the sound man on the video shoot. And I find when I come back to playing bass, it's like new again. And I, you know, it sounds crazy just to say it, but I get better ideas. I'll play my first bass solo that I play on a gig when I do get a bass solo. I find that I don't do what I always do. I do something completely different. It's good to get away from something. You can get stale. If you can afford to get away from it, if it's not costing you a lot of work, it's good to step away. And you come back, you're fresh, you're excited, you know. Yes, sir.
Did you ever consider opening your own pawn shop one day?
Oh my God, how did you know about that? I did, but I want to live.
We don't know the whole story.
Well, what he's talking about is when I lived in Los Angeles, everybody has a day job in Los Angeles. That's just how it goes. I met very few musicians who didn't do something else. When I got there, I got a job at a photo shop, which is ironic because then I just hated anything I had to do with photography because it was my job. Now I do it all the time. And we were developing, developing film. And then I did that for a year. Then I was a Domino's guy, Domino's pizza guy. Did that for about, I don't know, 6 months. And then Bad Brad, Bad with two D's, Bad Brad, my one of my best friends on the planet that I moved to LA to live with, said, yo, I got a job for you. Need a job? I got a job for you. It's at a pawn shop. And I thought just a pawn shop was a place you went that had dirty, dingy stuff to buy, broken stuff. I thought I literally thought that's where you go to buy broken stuff, right? Yeah, the pawn shop. And I stayed there for 6 years. I was a pawnbroker. And by the end of it all, you know, the sad part of that story is I quit playing bass. I got burned out. And I was so sick of all these stupid little non-paying gigs I was doing in rehearsals, and I'm learning other people's songs. And the last 6 months of my time in Los Angeles, I never touched the bass. And I was full-time pawnbroker. And I ended up in doing most of the, like, I know it's not a politically correct thing to talk about, but I was like the firearms salesman guy and paperwork and dealing with the government with that. And I worked at three different pawn shops around Los Angeles. It was the craziest thing I've ever done, and I will never be normal because of it. I'll never see the world the same way, and I'm pretty sure I lost a lot of years off the ticker on that gig. Yes, sir.
When you're in Nashville, did you play at the Grand Ole Opry?
Yeah.
And it, being an old building, I've heard the acoustics, being an old building, it rings out better.
It's pretty, you know what, it doesn't sound, it's cool. Well, there's two buildings. The Grand Ole Opry is a show, and that show takes place at a newer venue that's acoustically designed differently, and it's on the Opryland property, this mammoth hotel. If you ever come to Nashville, they have a canal through it. You can ride on a boat in a canal in a hotel. That's how big it is. And they built a facility, and they have the show, the Grand Ole Opry, there. But if you go to the Ryman Auditorium is that's the old theater, that's the Mother Church. That's what they call the Mother Church. And I mean, I get goosebumps talking about it. It's a spiritual event to be in there. It really is. And that place is not a great place to hear music. It's a church. You know, it's full of wooden pews. There's no treatment on the walls. So you go in and you go, yeah. So I'm at bass, and I'm playing my bass, you know, it sounds like next to but stepping on that stage, the first time I ever did it was, that was almost the same as, you know, last night was a big night for me personally. It was a similar feeling, because my grandparents that I love dearly and grew up next door to listened to the Grand Ole Opry show. That was at the Ryman, and all those artists, and it was a huge moment. And now it's like, you know, I can go down to Ryman, it's downtown, I got to park downtown. But it's a beautiful room, it looks amazing, and everybody that goes there feels like they've achieved something in their career. But it's not a great place to listen to music. I hate this, I hope they don't hear this. I love the building. I was telling Reese that, like, my father, I lost my father, and I have his ashes, and I shouldn't say this, Jay Rowling, it's probably illegal.
No, we won't put that up.
I'm going to leave his ashes somewhere that he wanted to go. He wanted to go, he never could go. He wasn't physically able to go, and so he's going to go now, and he's going to stay there until the vacuum cleaner comes.
Any Neil.
Is there a music style that you've always, I can't work out which way to ask it, that you've never wanted to play? Is there a particular?
You know what? And I've changed my mind. I've come around now. It took this long, but reggae. Not a reggae fan. Never was a reggae fan. And I think a lot of it was, I was such a clean cut kid, which is funny now, because now, like, you know, I didn't have, you know, we were out drinking the other night, you know, and I didn't do that. I was like the cleanest cut kid you ever met. I never had a beer until a few years ago. You know, I was drinking wine with my, you know, with my wife, drinking these new beer, all that, the vices of the world. I always attributed the vices of the world to reggae. They're all stoned. They're a bunch of stoners. They're playing behind the beat, man, because they're high. Not because they're good, because they're high. You know, that's just the way I was. And now I've gotten to where, like, holy cow, it's really cool. You know, I hear Bob Marley, and there's a movie, it's a Will Smith movie, one of those millions of Will Smith movies, where he's the last guy in the country I am a legend. I'm legend. And there's a moment in the film where he's trying to explain to this Brazilian woman what reggae is. She's like, what is that? He's playing a Bob Marley tune. He's like, that's reggae. And, you know, it's funny enough, when he's describing it in that movie, I was just watching a movie and it something clicked in me. And I went, that is kind of cool. And then I'm playing Bob Marley tunes sometimes in Nashville for artists. And all it changed my perspective. And I appreciate it a little bit more now. So that's the one. It was that one.
It was the one.
Yeah, I feel differently about it now. And now that I hear it, I don't instantly go change the station. I used to just go, the melody maker, you know. Now I'm like, you know what? That's actually pretty cool. So I've come around on that one. The music that I love and I gravitate to is like Tower Power. I love Rocco Prestia. I don't know if you guys are familiar with him, but he's one of my favorites on the planet.
Have you got any favorite Tower Power lines?
I mean, who doesn't love What Is Hip? Again, this is not the bass we play in What Is Hip on, but Rocco, what was cool about Rocco was he muted everything. He plays with his first finger, primarily, and the rest of the hand is a mute. There was a gig in LA on Monday nights, and Rocco was the bass player. So every Monday night, I go down and hear Rocco Prestia, and the drummer was this cat named Steve Monreal, and he was the drummer at that time. He replaced Garibaldi in Tower Power. So it's Tower Power's rhythm section in the band. And then eventually, the other members of the band would show up, and by the end of the night, it's Tower Power for $5, a paid $5 cover. And it was a sitting gig, and you could come in, you could sit in and play. And I could see Rocco play from this far away and watch him, you know. And that's not very funky, but so I can funk it up. And that's how he played. And that dude, that old codger is amazing. He's this crusty old cat, and he can just make it feel so good with these endless, like, doing the opposite of what you think you're supposed to do as a bass player. Bass player, solid, long, full, beautiful notes. Rocco was like short, clipped, sometimes aggravating, but funky and grooving. And he was the one, everybody, do you guys play Mustang Sally here? Is that like a, we always like, God, Mustang Sally. Rocco. Mustang Sally was Mustang. Better slow your Mustang. Mustang Sally. Mustang Sally, but that's how Rocco plays it.
Next gig, Steve. That's if you could do that, mate.
Rocco, that's how awesome. He would play it, and it was cool. It was so cool. It's bouncing. It like makes you sit in your chair and you're like, oh my god, I'm bouncing like he's doing it. And so that kind of music I love to play. And every now and then I get to do something when I'm with I fill in for the Wootons now. We'll play Mustang Sally. That's how I play it, you know. And I'm like, I get to do what I want to do. You know, this is great. And that I love. I gravitate to that. And that when I get to do that sort of thing and throw a little Larry in and a little thumb, I feel like I've come home to where I used to be when I was younger. And I feel like me. It's temporary. It's that gig. You know, at 1 a.m. when you pack your rig up, that's over. Switch gears and back to, you know. Which is nothing wrong with that. That is brilliant. I love this tune. I love all those songs. That's what's cool about the gig is it didn't play those cool songs. But just to answer your question in reverse, I'm attracted to that kind of stuff. Rocco was a huge influence on me. Huge one. I'll tell you one Rocco story, and he won't remember it. So I guess I can tell it. He tried to kill me one night. And the president of Trickfish stopped Rocco from killing me. And what happened was that gig, that Monday night gig, was a sit-in gig. And anybody would come in and sit in. I sat at a table and I recognized the guy sitting at the table with me. We all had to sit, you just grabbed a seat wherever you can get a seat. And the guy sitting across from me was Lewis Satterfield. Does anybody know where that guy is? He's not well known as a bass player because he's a trombone player. He plays for the Phoenix Horns with Earth, Wind & Fire. He did. He's gone now. But he and Verdine White wrote a bass book. They did it together. They're both on the cover without their shirts on. You see them from like here up. It's like total 70s. And that was one of like the books that I learned how to play bass with. And I was like, you're in my book. You're the guy. But at that gig, people would come and sit in. Stevie's bass player was there every night. He was always playing. I mean, I didn't even know who he was. He was just this big dude that was sitting at the table with him. And somebody said, Stevie Wonder's band. Holy cow, it's Nate Watts. He's sitting right here drinking a Coke. So we'd get it to play. And I would play a song. This is something that my roommate and I used to do. We'd pirate the show, not to keep, but to learn. Because we wanted to be able to play. It's a sitting gig, but you're playing with Tower Power, for crying out loud. You know, you get some interesting opportunity. Things can present themselves. So we would take little micro cassette recorders. It sounded terrible. It's like a dictaphone. You know, you can go, got a new idea today. Click, you know. And we would record the whole night in our pockets. And then we spent the rest of the week learning all the songs, their forms, their keys, the way Rocco, you know, Mustangs. You know, the way Rocco played all that. And when you would go to sit in, you know, the drummer would go, what do you want to play? What are you going to play? And I'd be able to go, whatever you want. Any of those songs, I know them all. They'd be like, no, you don't. Yeah, I know them all. I actually learned your entire night. So just pick one. And next thing you know, you got to do. Something crazy, but you would learn the way these guys played those songs, and they look at you completely different from that point. You're not just some punk that came saying you actually know all these tunes, and they it's good to do that. It's good to come in, and I guess I'm trying to give like an inside tip to everybody. If you have a chance to shed somebody's material, and it can, and you can just walk up and go, I can do anything you want to do. I know it all. I'm not being pretentious. I mean, I actually know your entire set. So one night, I got to play What Is Hip with Tower Power. And that's what that whole giant long story is about. It was the last song of the night. Rocco had asked if I wanted to play. I said, yeah, I would love to play. Just whenever you're ready, I'll go up and play. And it got to be the end of the night, so like 5-1. And they always ended the night with What Is Hip. So I got to play What Is Hip with Tower Power. And I'm up there playing on Rocco's bass. Rocco had store-bought action. Like, you know, you buy a bass at the store and you never change the action. That was his bass. And he had heavy gauge strings. And I used to get so much joy out of watching cats who didn't know what they were getting into go and sit on his bass. And they strap on his, I don't even remember what it was. It was a gift, like somebody gave him a bass. And they put it on and they look at the bass and, oh my God, it was so hard to play. But I got up there, I'm playing What Is Hip, and they stop in the middle of the tune, the drummer Steve Monreal is grooving, he's like, just play solo, just take a solo. And so I'm up there, broke a string, break the G string on Rocco's bass, and that dude, that did not end well. And the Trickfish president was, and he does, the funny thing is the Trickfish guy doesn't remember this. I said, dude, you saved my life. Rocco wanted to murder me, and Richard saved my life. But that gig was like the Wooten gig. It was one of those points in time where an amazing musical thing was happening, and people would come from miles around to see and witness it and be part of it, try to sit in and be in the band. And that's what it was like playing at the Wootens. That's Reggie Wooten, that's Victor Wooten's brothers. They have a band, and it was Wooten Brothers and Friends, and it was usually Raymond Massey on drums, but Victor and Roy would, Future Man would come in and play. The family would all get together and play sometimes, and it was like the musical world would just turn upside down for a minute. They were remarkable. But it was like that, those gigs were light. Every now and then, the planets align, and these amazing musical moments will occur. And if you're really lucky and really fortunate, you can, you find it, you see it, and just make it part of your life. Make it, don't miss a night if you can. The Wooten gig, everybody came in. Dennis Chambers would come in and sit in. Smitty Smith from The Tonight Show would come in and play drums. The Yellow Jackets drummer, Will Kennedy, I got to play with Will Kennedy. Everybody would come in. The drummer for Earth, Wind & Fire would come in. Everyone would always make that scene. And that was a crazy scene. That was a really crazy scene. Anyway.
Did you have another question?
I was just going to ask in regards to other genres or other styles, have you ever tried like rockabilly bass?
Oh yeah. I'm not very, that's not my, I'm not very good at it. And there's guys in Nashville who slay at it. They own it. You know, they have upright basses and stuff. But I love it. I like that it's like punk. It really is punk music. It's country punk music. Mm-hmm. But I haven't, I'm just not very good at it. I love it. I love the rebel side of it. Hank the Third, which is not really rockabilly, but I always imagine that he is.
So did you ever listen to a lot of that early rockabilly stuff as you were growing
up? Not really. I kind of got hip to it, believe it or not, from the Monkees gig, because the guitar player, Wayne Avers, that's kind of his thing. Surf,
yeah,
and rockabilly is his thing. And so when he and I would go do gigs, we play the Nashville Airport. It's like the best gig in town, believe it or not. They pay you great. You get to play whatever you want. You have a captive audience. They're sitting there listening because they're waiting on their plane. And we'll play all of Wayne's stuff. And it's rockabilly-esque stuff. Like I said, I never feel like I do it justice. But it's fun to play. It's a gas. And we'll do all his surf stuff that he'll do. And he's fabulous at that. That's his thing. Yes, sir.
Is there anyone that you would... either wish you had played with or aspire to play with?
My God, yeah.
Who, if you could pick like one or two people to, maybe one that you wish you had or maybe one you wish you could?
I got really upset that Scott Weiland died. He's a singer for Stone Temple Pilots.
Yep.
And I met him at the end. He was not in a good way. And when he passed away, I was like, I really... You know, you fantasize, you're driving down the road like, you know what, I could play with Scott Weiland. I could be a Stone Temple Pilot. I could be, you know, I would love that. And when he died, I was like, oh, this is never going to happen. As far out, as crazy as that idea is that I would get to do that, never going to happen. And that, yeah, I would love to have done like some creative music stuff with him. I always wanted to play with Alan Holdsworth. Alan produced a record, a rock, believe it or not, a rock record that I was working on. He was the producer. And I would drive and we carpool. And I was like that Saturday Night Live skit with Chris Farley and Paul McCartney. And I was like, you know, you remember that record you did, Road Games? It was really cool. And I'd be telling Alan naming all his stuff that he did. But we never got to play together. And when I was doing that record, I was spending all my free time learning his material, hoping that he would come out. I was playing some guitar, you guys. It's never going to happen, but... When Alan passed away, I was like, oh, that's never going to happen. Those are two guys off the top of my head. It's bands.
Anyone now, like, that you wish you could
play? That I wish you could play? I love Chaka Khan. And Donna kind of always had, like, a funny rivalry because one day I told her I love Chaka Khan. She's like, oh, really? You love Chaka Khan? You love Chaka Khan? That's like telling any woman that, I think that girl's great. Oh, really? You think that girl's great? She's great, isn't she? And so she would kind of needle me about that. She's joking, but I'm taking it seriously. Like, she's really mad at me. Yeah, she did a gig with Chaka, and she was like, I met Chaka, and you did. So I always loved Chaka. Anyway, I love Rufus. I'd love to play with Chaka, but her bass player is a badass, and he's not going anywhere anytime soon. He's great. Awesome. He's great. I love her. I love Tedeschi Trucks Band. I really wanted to get in that gig. There was a time period where they were floating around bass players after O'Teal left. And I would have loved to have that gig. That's a really cool gig. That musically, that's probably out there today. Musically, that's probably like the apex.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
Robert, you've done like lots of different genres, obviously.
Yeah.
Have you ever taken any inspiration from our music?
I'm going to plead ignorance. crowded house. I mean, and that's so obvious. That's like saying the Beatles. Crowded house that I know from the radio. I'm really ignorant of Australian music, and I hate to admit that in front of a lot of Australians. But I don't. I just don't know. I've never explored it. I've never been exposed to it. I know, you know.
Midnight Oil, yeah, of course.
Yeah, Midnight Oil. You know what? You know, those are the things that obviously were on American radio and getting played. And then I know that every time that is it Neil Finn?
Yeah.
Neil will come to Nashville and do shows, and it's funny, he doesn't do huge rooms. He'll do like a smaller to medium sized room or a large club, like a really big club that could fit a few hundred people in it. And it's like the indie turnout of Nashville is all the everybody who's cool and interesting is there to see that cat. He's worshipped there as a songwriter and performer.
Do you think that's why I got picked to play with Mac?
I would think so. He's kind of, he's in the songwriting world, he's like the darling of the songwriting world. It doesn't matter he's Australian, he's just amazing. You know, he's an amazing musician.
Awesome. Yeah,
and he must be a good dude.
Yeah.
You know, he must be a cool cat.
The Finn brothers are known to be really nice.
But you probably can't get your right team as the best tour,
I mean, that there's a reason. He does good work.
Yeah.
And he's known, Nashville loves him, that guy. I was amazed when he got that gig. I was like, I just didn't see that.
I can't
I didn't
wait
see
to
that.
See the show.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got tickets.
For I never imagined what that would be even be like. And I'm still kind of curious.
I can't imagine it'll be that Lindsay Buckingham. You obviously know King Bo, I don't know, but I've seen Fleetwood Mac a few times.
Let's see. You know, it's what awesome. It's like an NDA. It's like you can't say certain things, but you can spot the obvious.
Yeah. You know,
like you don't want to say anything horrible. You're like, okay, let's see. You threw your bandmate out that you've known for 30 years.
Yeah.
He was kind of your de facto leader, and you kicked him to the curb. So there's probably something going on, you know, something pretty obvious.
Yeah.
I hope that they work it out. I hope, you know, I know financially they want to work it out and make it work.
Yeah.
But everybody has to get along at all levels.
It's all apparently an awesome show.
At all levels, because you're traveling with these people.
You're living together.
Yeah, you're working together, and business, you need to make sound business decisions. And if somebody's not acting mature about something, you know, as your business partner, sometimes you need to make a move.
Mm-hmm.
You need to make a change. So hopefully Lindsay will be back, I guess. I don't know. I really don't, honestly don't know. I mean, we are, if you're in the industry, you hear things about people.
Yeah.
And it's not always true, but
no. But
sometimes if you just see the obvious, oh wow, they kicked them out after 30 years.
There's got to be a reason.
There's probably a pretty good reason.
About the direction that they were heading,
Well, you know what? They still do the same stuff they always did. And you think about it, it takes money off the table. If we go to purely financial conversation about it, the band is taking a huge sum of money off the table for them, for losing Lindsay. That's that. Promoters are like, well, it's not Lindsay Buckingham. I mean, I'm not going to. It's now I'm going to cut $25,000 off the, or whatever they're going to do. But it had to be pretty serious. And like I said, I'm sure for financial reasons they'll work it out. And there's probably some personal stuff. They probably have to work some things out. I mean, they all were basically married to each other at some point. And I can't imagine being in a band with my ex. I don't think, I'm surprised that they were able to pull it off.
They had some changes. I mean, Chris, they make bays, fade in and out, in and out. Definitely better band with her in.
Look at the band they got now. It's pretty incredible.
Yeah.
It's interesting too to see that, to mix it up. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Top
Penny,
the Heartbreakers guitar player, isn't he?
Yeah, absolutely.
Camp,
be good.
Your mic's wonderful.
Any other?
Yeah, Berkey.
Do you find that you're one that if you have 6 months off and you're not playing at all, are you one that you have to relearn, refresh, or it just goes from memory?
I mean, when you play,
it depends on how much you play.
Yeah, if you play most of your life, I think a lot of it is just kind of burned in.
Not
I remember when I was when I was younger, it was like if I didn't touch my bass for a week, I felt like I was starting over from scratch.
Yeah.
And now I feel like I can pick it up, and in 10 minutes, I feel like I'm kind of getting back to where I was. I'm not going to try any crazy feats of physical dexterity, but I could play the tune.
Yeah.
I think the longer you do it, you can get away and come back with less physical damage. If you're an acoustic guitar player, you're going to tear your fingers up when you get back. I don't have to deal with that so much. But if I was an upright guy, no, you can't walk away from it.
Yeah.
You have to maintain your calluses.
But I have done that. I've walked away from it for a minute, and it was, you know, I tried to be positive about it when I got back. Like, this is us fresh now. It's new. It's exciting. You know, and go ahead and pull out some old, you know, some old fun songs and play along and, you know, just do silly stuff and have fun.
Any other last questions?
I think we've driven them all away.
Yeah, sure. did you want to jam Superstition? Is that?
Yeah, we can do that.
Did you want to get that?
We can do Superstition.
We'll close out with that. Feel free to come and say g'day to John following this. Thank you very much to John as well. Thank we have a big round of applause. Literally off the stage of the Opera House last night, jumped on a plane, came out. Thank you very much for reaching out, mate.
Thank you. This has been fantastic, you guys. This has been awesome.
Welcome. Sounds like the Opera House would have been good.
It was great. It's surprisingly, it's really well treated. And if something weird happened, I walked out in the hall, or in the, like, you know, the hall that you walk around the performance room, does that make sense?
Yeah.
To get into the theater, and it's concrete everywhere you see, and if you go, it's dead as a doornail. There's no reflection. They've worked out all the reflections in the room. The Opera House itself has a little bit, but it's super manageable. We're actually able to play a little on the loud side, which normally in a live room you don't get to do. But no, we had a good time. I had to crank my rig a little bit. It's kind of cool.
It was actually the overall Palais volume, probably the nicest volume mix I've heard.
We were tighter on that stage.
Yeah.
No, that's I'm confusing my gigs. That was Perth, but the Palais, I think we had.
And they did the Astor Theatre in Perth. So guys up the back have played that and know that one.
That one we had to be a little quieter on. That was a little splashy out in the house, and the stage is tighter. And I had a wall of guitar amps around me. That was
cool. Drum beat, do you want to lick out on the start before we join in? If you want to have a bit of show off time.
Yeah. the devil's on his way.
John Billings, thank you so much for coming out and playing this tonight.